And the Oscar goes to Hans Zimmer, Dune.
Oh, quiet on the Western Front.
Trent Reznor, Atticus Ross, and John Batiste are so.
The Joker.
Black Panther.
Coco.
Let It Go, Frozen.
Lady Gaga.
And the Academy Award for Best Supporting Podcasters Impersonating Radio Show Host goes to the envelope. Jeremy and Jason from the Music Store.
You like me right now.
You like me.
You like
me. Really, really like me. That was Sally Fields, wasn't it?
It was.
I like Sally Fields.
Sure.
I mean, you can't hate on Sally Fields. So we just had the, I think it was the 94th Academy Awards. Sort of, kind of not, did watch it.
I did not.
You did not. See, I have like...
Not sort of.
Three girls in my house, and like it all starts with they watch the red carpet stuff, and then they watch it.
Okay.
And I just realized I had not seen like most of the movies, except I literally caught the very last scene of Barbie, at which point I won't ruin it for you. But I almost fell out of my chair. I was like, wait a minute, what was this movie about? I mean, I literally caught the last scene. Anybody who's seen it knows what I'm talking about when she goes to a particular appointment of which men do not go to.
Ugh.
Yeah, exactly what I said. I was like, what? And then I did see Oppenheimer. And I don't know where. I think it was on the plane. Yeah, we were away. I saw that on the plane.
Well, Jingle Jang Oppenheimer Smith? Is that what
no,
what is
Oppenheimer,
it?
About the nuclear bomb.
Oh.
That they built in the 40s today.
Okay.
And World War II. And it was all about... his life. Matt Damon was in it. Pretty good. I have to say, when that movie came out and they're like, oh, it's going to be the big summer blockbuster of 2023. I'm like, most people who aren't raging nerds like me are probably don't really want to watch a movie about a scientist. But that's, hey, it's a good movie. It won. However,
I beg to differ.
What?
There was a whole cinematic universe created around the first, well, after a slew of bad ones, they finally got kind of a good one.
A good one what?
Tony Stark. I'm not a Marvel guy, but yeah. He was a scientist.
But yeah, he's like a tough guy, cool scientist. That's right.
Yeah.
Is it cool if I take a picture with you?
Yes. It's very cool.
Well, this guy wasn't like that. He chain smoked cigarettes through the whole movie. Looks very frail. Like he needs definitely to eat some fruit or something. Yeah, Iron Man. And like, I think, what are they up to movie? Like the 12th movie now?
I don't know. I thought Tony Stark died in one of the movies.
Oh, I think he did. So one of the interesting categories in the Academy Awards is music. There are actually three musical categories.
Best original score, I would suppose, right?
Yep. Okay. We'll start with that one. So the original score, and Oppenheimer is the movie that won, and the composer, let's see, make sure I get his name right.
Where classical music has gone to in the modern age, right? Film.
Yes, except this guy, I don't think, came from a typical, like... orchestral arrangement, kind of.
Oh, okay.
Ludwig Göransson. You know, I couldn't be mistaken, but I think he did The Mandalorian also. He did The Mandalorian, The Book of Boba Fett. He's more like a synth kid, like a drum machine and synth kid that became a composer. And I think he went to USC. But any event, he won. The best part about that is this little clip I'm going to play you from his acceptance speech. Hold on.
Teresa Stanislav, Jake Brown, Chris Fogel, Anthony Parther, Alyssa Park, thank you for making the music sound great. And to my parents up there, thank you for giving me guitars and drum machines instead of video games. Thank you.
Now, I think that's a great closing line.
It's fantastic.
You know what I mean? Like, if the one thing he had to say, I'm glad I had music in my life growing up.
Yeah.
Let that be a lesson to all the childrens out there that they should, you know, if they did that, they could win Academy Awards.
Right. Don't play too much Atari.
I have to admit, I did my fair share of that. Real quick, there are some rules. Oh, so then the other ones are best song, and then there's best musicals, like where there's a group of songs that were written by, I think you have to have five songs written by the same group of people.
Okay.
So it's like three categories. And I think the last one to really get that was popular was like that Encanto movie.
Oh, sure, yeah.
We don't talk about Bruno anymore.
No, we don't talk about Bruno.
Oscar music rules that might surprise you from Billboard magazine. Now, this is back from 22. Maybe they changed it, but they have these different categories. The first one we were talking about is like there's original music for like a musical, right? So like I said, Encanto won that Purple Rain, 1984.
Mm-hmm.
So those are examples of like, you know, movie with like a lot of music by the same people. This one's interesting. No more than two Oscar statuettes may be awarded for best original score. So now think about that for a minute. You can't get more than two statues. Now, Trent Reznor, you mentioned, has gone into film composing, had one with John Batiste and Atticus Ross for Soul, which was an animated Pixar kind of movie about like a jazz guy who...
Yeah,
like,
I saw that actually.
It was cute. But they don't each get an Oscar. So there's this rule that no more than one statuette will normally be given in the original score category. A second statuette may be awarded when two credited composers function as equal collaborators, each contributing fully to the original dramatic underscore for the film. In cases where there are three or more credited composers that function as equal collaborators, a single statuette may be awarded to the group. Each composer must agree to the single, quote, group statuette option by signing and returning a group award form prior to the submission deadline. So I guess, first of all, I guess you submit your own stuff again to the Oscars, unlike kind of like our friend who didn't get his paperwork in. So if you have a group of people, you can't get like your own statuette, your own Oscar. Now, let's talk about some times where this could have posed some problems.
So, really, this what they're saying is it's not that you can't win multiple things. You just can't get the little trophy.
You don't get the statuette, the little guy. And that's really what everybody wants, right?
A bunch of grown adults all fighting over about a little thing.
Gold naked man. A naked gold man.
What? My mantle is bare.
do you shave it? Let's talk about a couple spots where that could have caused a problem. Let's go back to a little ditty of a movie that came out in 1970 called Let It Be.
The Beatles, rehearsing, recording, rapping, relaxing, philosophizing, creating. The Beatles, live in a new motion picture. Let it be,
let it be. Now, can you imagine that the Beatles did not each get their own Oscar statuette when Let It Be won the Academy Awards?
They didn't.
No. Same thing happened, I guess, with West Side Story. Stagecoach was like 1939, so maybe they came up with this rule a long time ago. And also The Last Emperor, which is 1987, Roichi Sakamoto and David Byrne and Kong Su. Now, David Byrne's another guy like Trent Reznor who like left sort of pop music and ended up going and doing some like cool avant-garde music, some classical music. He's got a record I have of like a string quartet, which is amazing. And then he's done movies as well.
Mm-hmm.
No more than four Oscar statuettes may be awarded for best original song. How is it that you can't do it for the original score, but the original song... you could go up to four statuettes. Now, the interesting thing about this is a lot of songs now have like six writers, seven writers in modern pop songs that find their way into the movies, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you're like number five guy, you don't get the statue?
Don't you have to give the statue back? Like the one you win on TV?
I think you're thinking of the Stanley Cup.
No, you got to give that thing back. They want it back.
That's the stage one.
And then they award you with another one.
They ship it in UPS or something later.
So you mean to tell me that the company that makes these things can't figure out a way to make, it's like we can only make a finite number. But what if we have more submissions?
I don't know. They just don't want to award them. I agree. I think it's kind of dopey, right? Especially like modern day pop songs, there's way more than four people on the song. No more than two songs from a film may be nominated for the best original song. Which I guess if you did more than two or up to five, then you'd be in the Encanto camp where I guess you'd be like a musical at that point.
Now, isn't this just the pretentious icing on the cake of award shows as it stands?
I guess.
You have won, but we're not going to send you a statue. Why? Because we said that no more than one or two could be awarded. Well, wait. It's like, isn't the accolade enough? You won. You won on some made-up show that's on TV. You got the award. You did it.
Well, it did come out before. That show started before there was even television.
Sure. But I'm saying.
But back then it was just like a dinner. You know, like they were like, yeah, let's get together and all like have a dinner and pat each other on the back.
You did it. Congratulations. Yeah. You did it. The accolade is enough. No, well, but I want the toy. I didn't come here for a Happy Meal that didn't have a toy in it. Yeah. I want the toy.
You know what's funny? I always laugh when they have these award shows and then they'll catch somebody like off camera, red carpet on the way out the door, and they talk about how great like the gift bags are.
Altogether, each gift bag is worth about $180,000. Not too shabby. Yeah. Pays to be living the high life, right?
Right. Because they'll give them like a, you know, like a $3,000 purse or something. Yeah. I'm like, you just got paid $200 million. This is interesting about the true nature of human beings, right? You just got paid $200 million to be in this movie. And you're stoked that you got a gift baggie.
Well, it's no different. I mean, it's just like being a kid. Like I said, you can bring your, not that I eat there, but you can go to McDonald's, bring your kid to McDonald's. Isn't it enough, small child, that I've decided to take you out for a special day and we're going to go out and we're going to get a bite to eat together. This is great, right? But I want the toy. Well, we're out to eat. You take your kid to the zoo or the aquarium and you walk through and you're like, my goodness, look at this animal. And then they exit to the gift shop. Now the whole day is ruined because you didn't buy
it's a setup. Yeah. The whole thing's a setup for the gift shop. Yeah, that happened to us. There was a vacation we were on and we went to like an ocean turtle rescue place. And you go through and you get to see these giant sea turtles and they've like, they get them out of the sand, they hatch the eggs, they grow them. Most of them they put back in, you know, get them back into wildlife. So it's great. But then, like, on the way out the door, nonstop giant stuffed sea turtle things for, like, $25, $30.
Yeah. And but the whole trip now is pointless. Nothing that happened before the gift shop has mattered now that the gift shop is here. Maybe. And you tell me how adults don't act the very same way. Well, can I get the toy? Can I get I want the statue, though. Well, you did win. We've said we're not going to give you one, but you did win. Everyone knows it. But I want the toy.
Well, what about like maybe like when you take your kids to the zoo then? Just bring like one of those like airplane eye sleeper masks before you, like when you, okay, hon, kids, we're going towards the exit. And you just slip the face mask over the kids. That way they can't see the stuffed animals.
I'd rather you see it, not know that you're not going to get it so you can appreciate what we just did.
Right. What if they charged you like, let's say, $5 to do the special exit that bypassed the gift shop?
That's an evil idea that if someone hears this show, they might in fact do it.
I mean, you have to weigh your options. $5 for express exit or walk through the gift shop.
We're nothing.
No, it's nothing for $5.
With a bare minimum, getting out of the gift shop alive, it means you're spending at least $15. So you're saving 10 bucks.
Yeah.
That's like my idea of like when people request songs I don't want to play at a bar. It's like, how much am I going to get to not play this song?
There was somebody, a jazz guy, who had told, came up with an idea to one of the clubs in the city way back when about like not charging, and I think he was busting the chops of another musician, but like not charging to go in and see the show, but then charging to leave. He's like, you don't charge people to come in, you charge them to leave. It's not enough for a song to be buried in the background of a scene. Now, this one I agree with, right? You can't be like, you just like, the actor gets in the car, he turns it on, and like his car radio is on, and there's a blurb of your song, and all of a sudden you're nominated for best song.
Sure.
So the rule is there must be a clearly audible, intelligible, substantive rendition of both lyric and melody used in the body of the motion picture as the first music cue in the end credits. Now, that's the other thing they always would do. Like, when the movie's over, then some song you hear for the first time comes out, and that's, like, often the one that they kind of push with, like, at least back in the MTV days. You'd be like, oh, I got this song. It's in the movie.
Yeah.
What was the one? Guns N' Roses doing
Live and Let Die.
Live and Let Die.
Yeah, yeah. What was at the end of? That was at the end of a Bond movie, wasn't it?
I think it was Live and Let Die.
Yeah, Live and Let Die, yeah.
Yeah. And then I remember we have Suffering through, like, Axl Rose, like, playing the piano and singing in a voice like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Singing the song. But it had nothing to do, it wasn't anywhere in the movie, because all James Bond movies open up with the James Bond theme, which is awesome. They do open with a song.
No, because Adele recently had one. What did she sing? She sang... What was it Skyfall?
Yeah, Skyfall.
Yeah. What a horrible song. Not even that bad of, not even a good movie. Sorry.
Wait, Skyfall wasn't a good song? I don't even remember that much about it.
Adele's music doesn't have a lasting impression on me, but
she is a great vocalist, so that's a weird thing. Like, she's, let's see if we pull that up. There's like Rolling in the Deep and some of these other songs she has. Like, I totally respect her vocals. There's that. I love James Bunn. I've drowned and dreamt this moment. Now that's good. That little melody's got a very Bond kind of like. Of course, our video is going to get blocked now for copyright, just letting it play this long.
That's a good drum fill.
A good drum machine fill.
Do you think it's drum machine?
That?
Is that?
I don't know. I'm pretty sure it's drum machine. Let's see.
No, that was really, yeah. That reminds me of the fill in that one Oasis song. Slip inside the eye of your mind. Don't you know you might find a better place to play? Don't Look Back in Anger.
Don't Look Back in Anger.
There's that great drum fill in the middle of the tune. Kind of feels like it's falling down a cliff.
They still can't agree to come back together and tour for, I think it's the 30th. It's amazing, like 30th anniversary of Morning Glory, whatever that record is.
That's fine.
That was just out in the news. Like they sure. Like, it's like, you guys are brothers. You both made a lot of money. Like, how bad could it really be?
That bad.
I guess so, yeah.
Whatever. The Bond theme. Right, isn't it? It's been for a long time that there's always been an original track that comes in the beginning of the movie, right?
Well,
or at least so it's Pierce Brosnan films. I feel like there's always been an original tune.
So usually the Bond movies, they have an opening scene. They have always have the theme, but then the song plays when the opening credits are going. Yeah.
So the movie can have opening credit. End credit, or it could serve as like the music is actually part of the scene itself. Meaning somewhere in the middle of the movie, it's gonna be really pivotal.
Right.
Okay. That's what constitutes, or that's what the criteria are to have to submit your song for this particular award. That I didn't know. I mean, it makes sense. You can't just have it on in the background and hear it for 10 seconds like you do like on some WB show or something like that.
On Her Majesty's Secret Service was the original James Bond movie.
This never happened to the other fella.
Also, with the only James Bond movie, it had the one random guy who never made another James Bond movie.
Oh.
Now that's very keyboard sounding for a movie that came out in like 1962. Or no, 67? Let's see when you're there. Now, definitely not the one we really know, right?
Yeah.
George Lazenby.
Huh.
First James Bond.
Wow. And right after him was Sean Connery?
Yes.
Okay.
I was a bit of a Roger Moore fan myself. I don't know why.
I like Pierce Brosnan, but only because it was my first exposure to Bond. That said, I've watched the ones past, and obviously Sean Connery's great, but the Pierce Brosnan ones were just because my introduction to James Bond was Pierce Brosnan, just because of my...
Well, that's the generational, right? Like, so mine was Roger Moore, because it was like late 70s, early 80s when I started watching those movies.
What can I say, Moneypenny, except that she is as attractive and as charming...
As I used to be?
I didn't say that.
Oh, you're such a flatterer, James.
Oh, Moneypenny, you know there never has been, and there never will be anybody but you.
A score must comprise a minimum of 35% of the total music in a film. Okay, a score must be created specifically for the eligible feature-length motion picture and comprise a minimum of 35% of the total music in the film. So I guess to have a score, that seems low, right? Like if you make a movie and you original music score by Jeremy Renner, but it's only 35% of the music that's played. That seems a little weird.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's like a lot of original compositions that just get put underneath scenes anyway, just movie score stuff that's just basically there. Probably wouldn't be entered into any category. You know, it's just, you could call it the best original score if maybe the music was such a major
movies that have no scores? Like,
well, there's plenty of comedies that don't have scores.
Well, like, what were you talking about? That movie from the 90s, Singles. It's all like 90s grunge music in the whole movie. So, but is there a score there? If there's not, if every piece of music only makes up, 8%, 10% of all the music and there's nothing else, then there is no score, correct?
I guess, I remember going, what about the new Batman movie? The newest Batman movie that came out with Robert Pattinson. They had the Nirvana track constantly playing.
We really gotta go, man.
Underneath the bridge, top is
tonight, a son lost a father. A wife lost a husband. And I lost a friend. Bobby. Mayor Mitchell was a fighter for the city, and I will not rest until this killer is found. This was a truly senseless crime.
Besides that, it was a mixture of ominous tones, kind of like a Law and
like
Order.
Like sound design.
Yeah, and just deep, ominous tones that just sort of happened. But then a theme was the Nirvana tune that was constantly playing throughout the whole thing.
They must have paid some big money for that then, right?
I'm sure. It's Hollywood. They have a lot of money.
We're going to do a combination reaction video, redo, redux, and information for people.
Okay.
The song that won was What Was I Made For by Billie Eilish, whose real name is Billie O'Connell, and her brother Phineas O'Connell. What nationality are they? Phineas O'Connell. It's not Spanish, is it?
I'm pretty sure they're American. Now
I just fall. I mean, it's kind of like we got St. Patty's Day coming up, right? Okay, here we go.
It's breathy. It's a very breathy song.
This is from the Barbie movie, just in case you didn't know.
Sure. Every little girl... This is the soundtrack of their head while they play with Barbies.
Oh, yeah. Like, I think if you even think of ragging on the song, you're going to get in big trouble. You're going to get a lot of hate mail.
I don't care.
I know.
What was I made for? Sounds like it's been recorded for ASMR listeners.
Yes. Okay. Well, it's funny. Somebody the other day on a Rick Beato show was talking about, how pop songs these days are more about actual sound design than they are about chord progressions and stuff.
Well, think about that low rumble that you hear before that drop. That I can't really describe what it is. It's just that before that kick drum fake sound, there's like that reverse reverb that builds up behind it and gives like this.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's just so...
Well, of course, the granddaddy of all songs that do that is Stroke. Stroke Me, Stroke Me.
Oh, yeah, he wanted to be Robert Plant the worst way.
Billy Squire.
Billy Squire, yeah.
You think he won?
Oh, dude, listen to his voice. Listen to the rockier tunes, like Led Zeppelin.
You think Robert Plant?
Oh, yeah, 100%. If you're in the
game. Now, when I first got my first guitar or drums or something, like, this was still a relevant song, you know what I mean?
Sure.
It was a rock anthem.
Yeah.
Was he ever known for anything else besides this song?
There's another one on there.
I like the groove on the song.
He's got another tune that's... the other really big Billy Squire hit. Real Zeppelin-y in the beginning.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Real Zeppelin-y. The other big hit that he had.
In the Dark? Oh, In the Dark. Lonely is the Night? That's the one, I think. Everybody Wants You? Let's try, look at this one. Lonely, I think it's...
There's a few, I guess.
This is the one. That's very Jimmy Page. Okay, I'll give you that.
Totally.
Yeah. Whatever happened to him? Did he die or something? Like, how come he's not just riding on that? What do you call it? The band legacy tour.
Legacy artist.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's so Zeppelin-y. I think he made a music video for a particular...
You're so right. I never... Like you just opened my... Like, my whole world has changed because I never made that association like he was wanting to be Jimmy.
He even had the hair of Robert Plant and his guitar player, you know, World Herbert recorded that, obviously going for that particular sound. I think he made a music video for maybe like a slightly more mellow tune, and he was like, he's a rock guy, right?
Yeah.
He's dancing around in it. He's like wrapping himself in his bed sheets, and it's rolling around. And apparently, it kind of trashed his career. He lost a lot of cred as being a rock dude after that. It was just kind of him prancing around with the bed sheets, and it was really, I'm serious. I actually, because I was talking about this with somebody else, and we're like, well, let's look into his career. And apparently, it took a hit after that particular music video came
really?
Out.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, who doesn't like prancing? Around in like bed sheets.
Yeah.
Toga!
Yeah, it was real. I don't know. People just didn't like it. Like, what's this rock guy doing? What is with this?
What's with the bed sheet, dude?
Yeah.
All right. Well, okay. So we're gonna play you our interpretation of What Was I Made For.
I don't think I even listened to it enough to get a.
Well, that's okay because through the power of digital audio workstations, we'll have 5 minutes to. To arrange it between the two of ourselves. Okay, here we go, everybody. I hope you enjoy listening to this as much as Jeremy did learning it.
You like me. You like me. You like me. You like me.